The Zoe Valley Memorial Library was founded in 1928 as a memorial to Zoe Valley Lightfoot and her love for the community of Chester. By the 1990s, however, time had eroded much of what the community knew of Zoe, and all that remained were a few personal effects, scraps of historical information, and some faded notes on her genealogy. This documentary is an effort to bring her story back to life and back to the community she so dearly loved. We begin our story with a voyage across the Atlantic Ocean and the first valet to settle in North America. In the late 1650s, Pierre Lavalley, a master surgeon, and his younger brother Jean left the diocese of Rouen in the Normandy region of France and sailed across the Atlantic to New France. They settled in the village of Beauport, which was not far from Quebec City. These images of Beauport were taken around the time of Zoe's death in 1927 by the photographer Edgar Garriepy. If Zoe had visited the home of her ancestors, this is how it would have looked. Beauport is now part of Quebec City, but parts of old Beauport still remain. This house is occupied by descendants of the original valets. In the period between the arrival of Pierre Lavalley and the birth of his grandson François Vallée, the population along the St. Lawrence River between Quebec and Montreal grew quite rapidly, and economic opportunities eventually became rare for the new generation. François Vallée, young and unmarried, decided to leave his established community, move westward to the south in search of opportunity. He made a long and difficult journey from Quebec all the way to the Upper Louisiana Territory, which still belonged to France, and settled first at Kaskaskia in Illinois near the Mississippi River. He eventually moved to nearby Sainte-Geneviève on the Missouri side of the Mississippi River. It was here that the Vallée family established themselves, both politically and financially, under the French, then the Spanish, and finally the Americans. François Vallée became one of the wealthiest men in Upper Louisiana through a combination of agriculture, trade, and lead mining. While the Spanish ruled the territory, he became commandant of Sainte-Geneviève and was given a family coat of arms by the Spanish king. He then changed his name to Francesco Valle and the name of his son, Jean-Baptiste, to Juan Batista Valle. His youngest son, Jean-Baptiste Vallée, blessed with his father's talents and discipline, led the family into the 19th century. He had a long life, living 89 years from 1760 until 1849, the year Zoe was born. He even lived long enough to be part of the age of photography, as we see here. His house is still one of the most important in the town.
Okay.
Apparently started as a fort in the last few years before Louisiana was turned over to the Americans in 1803. Jean-Baptiste used the house as a residence, and the house became a social and political hub of Sainte-Geneviève. These photographs of the house were taken around the 1930s and show how the house would have looked around the time of Zoe's death. Jean-Baptiste Vallée II, who was Zoe's grandfather, died before his father, and the bulk of the family estate went to his brother, Félix Vallée, who is shown here in his later years. By this time, most of the Vallée fortune was invested in industrial concerns, such as the Iron Mountain Company, which were involved in the mining and processing of iron, and eventually the manufacture of products such as iron rails for the expansion of the railroads in the American West. Félix Vallée's house in Sainte-Geneviève is now a state historic site, part of Sainte-Geneviève's National Historic Landmark District.
Félix Vallée and his wife ended up living in the house, and Vallée family businesses were operated from the commercial side. Primarily, this was a trading firm known as Menard and Vallée, and it encompassed trade throughout an area here in southeast Missouri that was pretty large. They dealt in a lot of manufactured goods, things that came from the eastern part of the United States, shipped here by steamboat, but they also were involved in the fur trade, lead trading, all sorts of business activities.
The house was built in 1818. As an American federal style residence and mercantile store. Restored and furnished to reflect the 1830s, the home today interprets the American influence on the French community following the Louisiana Purchase. Félix Vallée had only one child, Louis, who died as a young man. It would fall to Félix's nephew, Jules Vallée, to take on the responsibility of the family businesses. Jules Vallée, who was Zoe's father, was born in 1820. In this diorama, we can see how Sainte-Geneviève would have looked in 1832 when Jules was a young boy. He was educated in a seminary near Perryville, Missouri, and as a young man, he became the superintendent of the family mines. When he was 24 years old, he married Isabella Sargent. Their first three children all died before the age of three, and Zoe, their fourth child, was born in 1849. The family house, quite large by Sainte-Geneviève standards, no longer exists. It later became a bank, which was apparently robbed by Jesse James and his gang. In 1852, 3 years after Zoe's birth, the family moved to St. Louis, which is about 100 kilometers from Sainte-Geneviève. St. Louis, at this time, was an important trading center on the Mississippi River, and as the gateway to the West, would become the fourth largest city in the United States by 1900. Zoe's father became a very important figure in the city. Involved with the Vulcan Iron Works, the Mechanics Bank, and the St. Louis Life Insurance Company. Despite his success in business, he still retained the frontier spirit of his great-grandfather. A friend of one of his children writes of seeing in Jules Vallée's study in St. Louis, guns and rats, stuffed birds on the mantle, mounted heads of elk and bison, flint implements, and other Indian relics. Jules Vallée died in 1872 at the age of 53. He is buried in the family plot in the Bellefontaine Cemetery in St. Louis. He is remembered in Saint-Geneviève with a memorial stained glass window in the Catholic Church there, beside another window that is in memory of his great-grandfather François and his four children who died young. The children were moved from Saint-Geneviève to rest beside him in St. Louis. At the time of Jules Vallée's death, the family was living at 2710 Washington Avenue in St. Louis. The house shown here is long gone, of course, as are most of the houses in the area. We can get an idea of what the house must have been like by looking at the Campbell House Museum, which is located on nearby Locust Street. The Campbell House Museum, shown in these photographs from 1940, opened in 1943 and was the home of St. Louis businessman Robert Campbell. It not only preserves the Campbell's house, but also their collection of original furniture, fixtures, paintings, objects, and thousands of pages of family documents. Included in these documents is a unique album of 60 photographs of the interior of the house taken in about 1885. In 2005, the museum completed a 5-year restoration that returned the building to its opulent 1880s appearance when the house was one of the centers of St. Louis society. The executive director of the museum thought that the Vallée House would have been larger and more grand, judging by its location and the status of the Vallée family. We know that Mrs. Vallée and her daughters Zoé and Isabelle spent some time in Paris after Jules Vallée's death. In 1882, Mrs. Vallée had her portrait done by the American painter John Singer Sargent, who was living in Paris at the time. She is painted still wearing her mourning dress 10 years after her husband's death. Sargent also painted Zoe's 18-year-old sister Isabelle, who would eventually inherit Zoe's Chester property and donate it for use as a library. Singer Sargent would later paint many portraits of European and American society families like the Vanderbilts, the Astors, the Rockefellers, and American presidents such as Woodrow Wilson. Trips to Paris would have been exciting for the Vallée women from Sainte-Geneviève. A chance to practice their French and see the latest fashions. In fact, the only photograph we have of Zoe was taken in Paris when she was around the age of 35. A number of Zoe's personal books have always remained in a library and are now kept for display only. Some of these books revealed a little mystery. In certain books, it was found that the page containing her last name was either torn or neatly clipped out. Before our research in St. Louis, we assumed that there was some problems in her marriage to Alfred Lightfoot, but it turns out that she had been married before when she was 21. St. Louis, after the Civil War, was the gateway to the Wild West, and there were many men looking to make their fortune. Zoe's first husband was a bookkeeper named John Picton. After marrying Zoe, he started a business trading in cotton, and only 3 years into the marriage, he was arrested for obtaining $19,000 worth of cotton under false pretenses. There was more scandal to come. It seems that after her husband's death, Mrs. Vallée had to rely on Zoe's husband for financial dealings. In 1877, Mrs. Vallée gave Picton $60,000 in bonds to take to her bank and have some of the coupons cashed. Instead, he took the bonds to his own bank and cashed them for himself. This would have been over $800,000 today. Picton moved into the finest hotel in St. Louis and continued in the cotton business. In 1881, Zoe filed for divorce. Picton threatened to use as a defense that Zoe refused to perform her duties as a wife and had deserted him. This defense would have caused a scandal for the Vallée family if it had reached the court. A divorce settlement was finally reached, in which Picton gave up all claim to Zoe's estate in return for an additional $8,000 and the forgiveness of his previous debt to Zoe's mother. This would bring the cost of getting Picton out of the Vallée family to close to $1 million in today's dollars. On November 17, 1887, at the age of 38, Zoe began a new life. The St. Louis Society pages reported, "At 5 o'clock yesterday afternoon, Zoe Vallée, daughter of Mrs. Jules Vallée, was married to Mr. Alfred Lightfoot, a young lawyer of Birmingham, Alabama. The Reverend Robert performed the wedding ceremony in the presence of the family at Mrs. Vallée's home on Washington Avenue. Monsieur Amédée Vallée gave the bride away. She wore a Parisian costume of rich blue silk with garniture of point lace, and on her arm, the groom's present, a bracelet of sapphires and diamonds. The same newspaper also reported, Zoe Vallée gave a very handsome dinner to Mr. Alan Pendleton this week, in payment of a bet made sometime since. One might speculate that this dinner, being held in the same week as her wedding, that Zoe had vowed that she would never marry again. Given her experience with her first husband, it seems like a reasonable bet. Alfred Ross Lightfoot was born in Pass Christian, Mississippi, on June 2, 1852. His father, William Lightfoot, originally from Port Royal, Virginia, was mayor of Pass Christian. His mother was Sarah B. Ross of Mobile, Alabama, who was the daughter of Jack Ross, the first state treasurer. The family had an estate on the Gulf Coast next to the Pass Christian Hotel. The Pass Christian Hotel, shown here, was the birthplace of the Southern Yacht Club, the second oldest yacht club in America. Pass Christian, with its balmy climate, peaceful shores, and charming hotels, was in Alfred's day an internationally known resort, and the Gulf Coast was called the American Riviera. Alfred developed a fondness for sailing that would last a lifetime. After the Civil War, his father lost a large cotton plantation and all of his slaves. The family moved to Mobile, where father and son both became lawyers. Alfred Lightfoot's parents are buried at the Magnolia Cemetery there. Zoe Vallée Lightfoot had no children, and that made it less likely that information about her would endure after her death. This library is her memorial and her legacy. Perhaps if we looked to her family, we will understand more about her life and why this library exists today. Zoe had seven brothers and sisters who survived to adulthood. Younger brother Jules Félix Vallée became a prominent doctor and teacher in St. Louis. Apparently, one of his daughters, Marie-Isabelle, was pronounced as America's most beautiful girl by Newport, Rhode Island society ladies, Mrs. Vanderbilt, who lived at Marble House, and Mrs. Robert Goulet, who lived at Ochre Court. Marie-Isabelle married Sir James Hope Nelson and moved to the family home in England. Dr. Vallée's son, also named Jules Félix, became wealthy in St. Louis, working as a stockbroker with George Herbert Walker, who was the great-grandfather of President George W. Bush. Jules Félix Vallée, Jr., retired to Sainte-Geneviève with his wife Anna when he was 48, and they proceeded to restore what is now known as the Guibourg Vallée House, shown here in these black and white photographs from 1937. They installed heat, running water, and electricity. After Jules Félix died in 1949, Anna Marie, something of an outcast in a genteel town because she had been a showgirl, traveled and shopped the world, until her own death in 1971. She filled the house just a good-sized cottage by today's suburban standards, with museum-quality Louis XV, Louis XVI, and French Empire pieces, as well as Venetian mirrors, a 1790 crystal chandelier, and screens from China. She put jade plates around the light switches and hung portraits of her husband's ancestors on the walls. Upon her death, she donated the house to the Foundation for the Restoration of Sainte-Geneviève in her husband's memory. Today, the house and grounds are a museum that are part of Sainte-Geneviève Historic Landmark District. Zoe's sister Grace married Jesse Lindell January, son of the builder of the Lindell Hotel in St. Louis. They had one daughter named Isabelle, and the family spent most of their time at the resort they own at San Remo on the Italian Riviera called Villa Isabella. San Remo saw a rapid growth in the middle of the 19th century with the development of tourism when the first grand hotels were built. The town attracted Americans such as Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, shown in San Remo in 1905, and Europeans such as Alfred Nobel, who had a villa there. Villa Isabella was a base for the Valli family when they traveled to Europe. They would usually travel from New York to Genoa, and then from San Remo, they would venture on to destinations in France, especially Paris. Robert Summers Brookings was a close friend of Grace Valli January, Zoe's sister, who made his fortune and retired at the age of 46 to devote his life to public service. He played a key role in the development of Washington University in St. Louis. Brookings was a regular visitor at Villa Isabella in Italy and grew close to Isabelle, Grace's daughter, even though there was a 26 years age difference. Grace Valli January died in 1919, and her daughter Isabelle inherited the family fortune. She collaborated with Brookings on philanthropic projects, such as paying for the construction of January Hall at Washington University in the memory of her mother. January Hall was home to the School of Law for 50 years, and the former law school reading room is now the East Asian Library. In 1927, the year after Zoe died, Isabelle, her niece, married Robert Brookings. They settled in Washington, where Brookings was establishing his nonprofit public policy organization, which would become known as the Brookings Institution. The Brookings were very close to Isabelle Valli Austin, Zoe's sister, shown here with Robert Brookings, who was aunt and most likely godmother to the young Isabelle. A sergeant portrait of her hung prominently in the Brookings Washington home. In 1929, she contributed in memory of her mother the bulk of the money to build the Brookings Institution's new building in Washington, D.C. 5 years after their marriage, Robert Brookings died in 1932. Mrs. Brookings was made trustees of the Brookings Institution in 1949 and remained one until her death in 1965. Isabelle Valli who was 15 years younger than her sister Zoe, married George Austin, a partner in Russell & Company, America's largest sugar importing firm. In 1896, the couple acquired Sweetbriar Farm at Geneseo in western New York from the Wadsworth family. The Austins built a 27-room mansion in stables at the top of the hill overlooking the Genesee Valley. They lived in this beautiful house for only 8 years, as Isabelle was to suffer disappointment in her marriage, just like Zoe, her sister. It seems that, unknown to Isabelle, her husband had adopted a young schoolteacher named Julia Reynolds. It is likely that this was a child from a previous relationship, as by 1907, George Austin was living with his adopted daughter in a fine house in Boston, which he had recently purchased for the girl's mother. Isabelle sued for divorce and to have the adoption annulled. It seems only the divorce was successful, as Julia Reynolds Austin was living at her own estate named 4 Acres in Charlottesville, Virginia by 1919. Isabelle sold Sweetbriar Farm in 1906 and moved to the small town of Newport, New York, where she continued to live until after Zoe's death in 1926, when she donated Zoe's Chester property for use as a library. She never married again, and she had no children. She passed away in 1947. It is interesting to note that the Wadsworth family, who sold her the property in Geneseo, established one of the first free public libraries in the U.S. in 1842. It is still in operation today. Perhaps this is how Isabelle, and maybe even Zoe, came up with the idea of establishing a free community library in Chester, using Zoe's summer home after her death. After Zoe Vallée and Alfred Lightfoot were married in St. Louis in 1887, they spent some time in Alabama. Lightfoot had moved from San Francisco to New York City in 1878 and was practicing law in Manhattan. The Lightfoot's first residence in New York was on West 39th Street, near Bryant Park and the site of the New York City Public Library. Alfred Lightfoot had his office at 32 Broadway near Wall Street. Near the turn of the century, the Lightfoots moved to the Upper West Side of Manhattan, very near to the newly built Dakota Apartments in Central Park. This area was sparsely populated at the time, and they would have lived in a townhouse very similar to this one on West 71st Street. Alfred Lightfoot was a member of the New York Southern Society, which was one of the most popular social organizations in the city. He also maintained his interest in sailing, being noted in the New York Times on several occasions as being a guest on the various yacht of Seymour Halstead Jr., Commodore of the Larchmont Yacht Club. Halstead owned railway and transportation system in Brooklyn, New York, and was also a member of the Atlantic Yacht Club. Lightfoot, as either a friend or lawyer, socialized with Halstead at the New York Yacht Club at their beautiful clubhouse on West 34th Street, built by then Commodore J.P. Morgan. This club is one of the world's most distinguished and influential yachting institutions. The clubhouse, which has been declared a National Historic Landmark, contains the world's largest collection of full and half-hull models. With Halstead and the New York fleet, Lightfoot sailed to regattas at Nantucket and New London. He would socialize with other New Yorkers, such as Henry Flagler, the railroad tycoon, who sailed on his steamer Alicia, and Cornelius Vanderbilt Jr., another railway owner, who built the well-known house called The Breakers in Newport, Rhode Island. His yacht was a 46-footer called Ilderim. Manhattan was unpleasant in the sweltering heat of the summer. Those who could afford it flocked to the alluring roof garden theaters, an oasis of cool fresh air, full of frivolity and fashion. Some moved to the nearby country or beach houses for the summer, while still others went further north to such places as Cape Cod, Massachusetts, and Bar Harbor, Maine. This tide would keep moving north, eventually reaching Nova Scotia. The evolution of the summer colony in Chester was influenced by the northward push of Americans along the eastern seaboard, seeking ever more quiet and remote destinations to escape the hot summers at home. Dr. Finney, who bought Little Fish Island, first tried Ocean City, Maryland as a vacation spot, then New Jersey at Cape May, next Rhode Island at Jamestown, and finally Cape Cod at Wyoming. It wasn't until he tried Chester that he felt he was far enough away from Baltimore that he wouldn't be called back for emergencies. Bar Harbor, on Mount Desert Island in Maine, has a fascinating history as a summer resort that sets the stage for Chester's development as an American summer destination. In the 1850s, painters such as Frederick Church and Thomas Cole popularized the area through their exhibits of the island's beautiful mountains and seascapes. The first hotel on the island was built in Bar Harbor in 1855. Alpheus Hardy was the first summer resident to build a cottage called Birch Point in 1868. More and more hotels and cottages were built as people came to the island by train and by the Mount Desert Ferry. Beginning in 1868, wealthy, powerful, and influential summer visitors from Boston, New York, and Philadelphia, the Astors, Rockefellers, Vanderbilts, Carnegies, and Morgans, came and built magnificent cottages, some containing over 100 rooms. Bar Harbor had become a rival with Newport, Rhode Island, as the place to be seen and to play in the 1880s through the first part of the 20th century. Not all visitors had cottages at Bar Harbor, at least not right away. The influx of summer visitors and the reputation of the town made hotels a profitable investment. By 1880, there were 30 hotels in Bar Harbor, and at one point, reservations for room had to be done 2 years in advance. In 1881, the Roddick House, Bar Harbor's largest hotel at that time, was expanded to 400 rooms, with an enormous dining room and a 500-foot-long and 25-foot-wide porch running along the front in one side of the building. The main attraction to the hotel seemed to be the lobby, known as the fish pond, and the porch, where young ladies dallied fishing for husbands. The hotel era dominated the resort for about two decades. Ultimately, the cottages built by America's rich and famous took over the landscape. All of the old hotels are now gone, either torn down or burned down by the Great Fire of 1947. Many of the cottages burned also, but some remain. One that remains is Ulacana, which was the Bar Harbor home of Zoe's sister, Grace Valley January, in the late 1880s, when the family still lived in St. Louis. After her husband died, Grace and her daughter, Isabel, relocated to the Italian Riviera at San Remo. Today, Ulacana is one of the summer homes that has been converted into an inn. Many of the other cottages that remain are now private homes, much as they were 100 years ago. Another similarity between Bar Harbor and Chester is the presence of a memorial library. With 176 volumes and a gift of $20, the original Bar Harbor Village Library came into existence in 1875 through the combined efforts of seasonal and year-round residents. It was located in a building that soon became too small for the collection. The Jessup Memorial Library was finished in 1911. Mrs. Marriott Jessup presented the library to the town of Bar Harbor in memory of her husband, the late Morris Ketchum Jessup, a New York financier and philanthropist who had summered many years in Bar Harbor. The library is a non-profit organization and is operated by a volunteer board of directors, much like the Chester Library. Funding is provided by endowment income, an annual fund drive, and a municipal stipend. Chester is the vestibule of heaven. These were the words of a summer resident quoted by Nova Scotia travel writer Clara Dennis in 1937. Other description was just as effusive. The Riviera of the East, Acadia's Eden. The evolution of the area as a summer Eden was made possible by the hotels of Chester. One of the earliest was the Mulgrave, which was built in the 1820s. Another hotel dating from the 1820s was the Lovett House, built by Mr. and Mrs. Charles Lovett. Tourists from Boston, New York, and Philadelphia started staying there as early as 1850. As business increased and more rooms were required, the Lovetts had to buy a house across the street, known as the Annex. The Columbia House was the first hotel to cater almost exclusively to American summer visitors. Edward Robinson Jr. advertised his hotel in American newspapers and attracted visitors from New York, Washington, and Pennsylvania. One of the guests at the Columbia House was Mrs. Zoe Valley Lightfoot. Around 1898, what would be known later as the American Summer Colony began to be established in Chester. Instead of just staying in local hotels, visitors were becoming more involved and more attached. In 1885, Philadelphia industrialist John Wister and his wife purchased a house that is known as the Blockhouse. His family still summers there. Professor Lindley Kisby and his brother had first come to Chester on a bicycle tour. Professor Kisby, from Philadelphia at the time, bought the land and building that was the First Baptist Church, and with additions, established the Accmatack Inn. He also built a house for himself and his wife that became known locally as the Gibb House. He owned the Accmatack until 1917, when his anti-war activities in America ruined his teaching career. He had a difficult life until his death in 1946. Kisby joined with locals from Chester in forming the Chester Tourist Association, which published a promotional newspaper called the Chester Breeze. An article in the Chester Breeze suggested that the growing tourist industry could well make up for a declining fishery in a slowing logging industry. Another supporter of the Tourist Association was Dr. Charles Simon. Dr. Simon was a virologist from Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland. He bought land at Walker's Point and built one of the first summer homes. In a letter published in the Chester Breeze in 1898, Dr. Simon implored, "Preserve this integrity of natural beauty by preserving your forest. Let not a tree be struck down where trees are not abundant, unless a new tree be planted in its place." Dr. Simon was soon visited by two colleagues from Johns Hopkins Hospital, who also established summer homes here. In this group photo, we see Dr. Simon in Chester with Dr. Finney and his close friend, Dr. Russell, and various family members. Dr. Finney bought Little Fish Island and the home that had been built for General Theodore Bingham, the New York City Police Commissioner. Dr. Russell rented a house next to Dr. Simon that would eventually become the summer home of the Bartlett family, also of Baltimore. Chester, during Zoe's time from 1903 until 1927, was becoming well established as a summer destination. Pastured land on Nossus Point in the peninsula began to transform into summer homes. The Chester Yacht Club was established in 1902. Many summer visitors owned yachts for racing, cruising, or sailing to nearby islands for picnics and hikes. While many activities involved the water and the beautiful surroundings, there was always an opportunity to get lost into a good book, whether here at the Hackmatack or on the veranda of one's summer home. Zoe Valley Lightfoot was among the first summer visitors who acquired property for use as a residence for part of the year. Using her own funds and keeping the property in her name, she purchased the property at the corner of Central and Regent Street from John Weber in February of 1903. Although the railway came to Chester in 1905, Zoe traveled to and from New York by steamer. There was a regular service between St. John's, Newfoundland, Halifax, and New York. Two of the ships that Zoe traveled on were the SS Sylvia and the SS Rosalind. When returning to New York, she would have to be processed through Ellis Island, and it is from records there that we learn that she traveled with another woman, her own age, named Caroline Peters. Miss Peters was probably a lady's maid or a companion, essential for a woman of Zoe's status who was traveling alone. In fact, the Ellis Island records only note one trip by Alfred Lightfoot from Yarmouth to New York in 1904. Not much information about Zoe's time in Chester has survived. The deed that transfers the property to the municipality states that Zoe took a deep personal interest in the village of Chester, in its people, in their activities, and also rejoiced in the beauties of Chester and its environs, and in many ways endeared herself to the citizen of the said district. We do know that around 1910, the station master at the Chester train station was Pierre Jean-Baptiste Lafrance. He and his wife and five children lived upstairs at the station. Many afternoons, Zoe would spend an hour chatting in French with the family to keep up her linguistic skills. She was also close to the Lordley family, who were her neighbors across Central Street. Zoe became friends with the children of Charles Lordley, Chester's first municipal clerk. Captain Edwin Lordley, taking over from his father, was municipal clerk treasurer during Zoe's time in Chester and lived in the Lordley House, which was also known as Evergreen Hall. Edwin's sister, Lillian, received this hand-painted Parisian postcard with Christmas greetings from Zoe, asking her not to forget old friends. It was a thoughtful card, as Lillian did hand-painting on silk, according to an ad from the Chester Breeze. Lillian Lordley eventually married and moved to California. Edwin's brother, James Lordley, was a doctor practicing in Manhattan. It is not clear whether Zoe knew him before or after coming to Chester, but his Masonic Lodge was in the same building as Alfred Lightfoot's office. He passed away in Chester in 1913, 2 years after Alfred died. A cane given to him by his lodge brothers still remains in the library, perhaps used by Zoe in her later years. Ellis Island records show that Edwin Lordley's son, Lionel, traveled with Zoe on the steamer to New York when he went to visit his uncle James. Lionel eventually inherited the Lordley house while his sister Edwina later married Sir Adrian Chamier and moved to England. Alfred Lightfoot built an observation tower behind his house in order to watch the yacht races and sailing activity in the bay. Due to the lack of mature trees at the time, he would have had a commanding view. There were several other towers in Chester at the time, such as the one at the Pinehurst Inn near Stanford Lake. Alfred Lightfoot died of heart failure at home in Manhattan in December of 1911 and was buried in the Valley family plot in St. Louis. Zoe continued to summer in Chester until the age of 76, renovating the house, adding new wood floors throughout, and putting additions on the rear. On October 27, 1926, Zoe Valley Lightfoot died of pneumonia at the Victoria General Hospital in Halifax. Her sister, Isabel Valley Austin, and her niece, Isabel Valley Brookings, came to Halifax and arranged to have her remains sent to St. Louis, where she was laid to rest with her husband and parents in the Valley family plot at the Bellefontaine Cemetery. In 1913, four summer residents approached Mrs. Frank Frieda, whose home was near the Lovett House, across Union Street from the current post office, about having a library for the village. Mrs. Frieda made a room available in her house and acted as librarian for 9 years. This library, the Chester Lending Library, was moved in 1922 to the home of Mrs. S. Frieda and had by then increased to 15,000 volumes. Zoe Valley Lightfoot would probably have used this library and might even have expressed concern for the need of a permanent library to her sister, Mrs. Isabel Valley Austin. In the summer of 1927, 8 months after Zoe's death, her sister contacted Miss Dorothy Gilman and offered Zoe's property to the municipality of Chester to be used as a free public library. Dorothy Gilman summered for many years in Chester at White Gate, overlooking the Back Harbor. She was the daughter of Arthur Gilman, a banker, philanthropist, and author. He founded Radcliffe College, the women's college associated with Harvard, partly because he wanted his own daughters to have an opportunity for higher education. Gilman even learned the manual alphabet to work with Helen Keller, who graduated from Radcliffe College in 1904. Dorothy Gilman and her friend, Miss Paxson, were prominent in the social life of Chester. This photo shows them at a tea party they hosted. They were also much involved with sailing and with the yacht club. They owned a boat called the White Heather, which was the first boat designed and built by Reuben Eisler in his new boatyard on the Back Harbor. Miss Gilman dealt with the municipal clerk, Cottenham Smith. They held a meeting of taxpayers to take some action with respect to the offer of Zoe's property until the matter could be dealt with by municipal council in January of 1928. The municipal office at that time was across the street from the first municipal office, which was located behind the Lordley House and near Zoe's property. At this meeting, an objection was raised by some who saw the possibility of increased taxation for the upkeep of such an institution. Mrs. James Starr of Philadelphia, who summered at Wisteria, offered to contribute $1,000 toward an endowment fund, providing a sufficient sum could be raised to take care of the upkeep and equipment of the property as a public library. A resolution was passed to have municipal council accept the gift, and a committee was formed to arrange for the establishment of the library. This committee was key to the existence of the library and included both summer and year-round residents. Frederick Folk was a businessman and mayor of Oshawa, Ontario, from 1898 to 1907. He served as a member of parliament from 1908 until 1911. While he was an MP, he added a library to his Oshawa house that was built in the shape of the parliamentary library in Ottawa. Today, his house is a law office and still features the literary-themed stained glass windows he had installed.
Well, our family connection with Chester, in fact, began because of the Halifax explosion in 1917. And our grandfather came here to Nova Scotia from Oshawa, Ontario, where he was a member of parliament, to be a part of the Relief Commission. And then a couple years later, he brought his family down, and they came to Chester, and they fell in love with the village. And then they bought the house, and that was in 1920. The house was built in 1908, and they bought the house in 1920. So it's been in the family since then.
Our grandmother toured around the South Shore when our grandfather was working in Halifax with the Relief Commission, and she happened to find Chester and happened to find this house, which was for sale. And it was pretty much the only house out here on Frieda's Point, so it was pretty prominent, and I guess she couldn't miss it, and fell in love with the place, and I guess convinced our grandfather to buy it. And so from then on, it was one of the first ones out along here. There was an old farmhouse over here owned by the Friedas, which is now gone, long gone. And the place was pretty much barren of trees. It was just farm field, and we've got old photographs of it in black and whites, and quite beautiful with hay wagons and oxen and the fields.
And then I suppose when he came here, he brought many of his books, and we still have those books which he had in our other house. And our grandmother, he loved to buy books, and his wife sometimes didn't like him acquiring so many, and so he'd hide them in his pockets and sneak them into the house that way.
Frederick Folk moved key resolutions on the library committee, and as a keen lover of books and libraries, was determined to see it established. He died in 1939 at the age of 82, and his grandchildren still summer at the house on the peninsula. Without Mrs. James Starr, the library would never have become a reality. Sarah Logan Wister Starr was born in 1873 near Philadelphia to John Wister who had purchased the blockhouse in Chester in 1885.
My great-grandfather was a sports fisherman in the after the Civil War, which was over, the American Civil War, which was over in 1865. And he, for some reason, decided to go to Scotland for salmon fishing. Now, that's a long way to go, and he went by sailing ship, and I think he went by himself for 2 years. And at that point in time, say 68, he was instructed or asked why he came over there and why he didn't come over here in his own continent. And he said, so the story goes, asked where is this place you're talking about, the guide. And the guide said Nova Scotia. And my great-grandfather said the same thing that a lot of people say today, where's that? And he came home and researched it. And then the spring of 1870, let's say June, that's late spring, early summer, he and his wife and his newly born daughter, Elizabeth Wister Wirtz, had to come up here. They didn't know where to go. And they must have spent a good part of the summer sailing in renting a, we would call a chartering today, a sailboat or something that would move up and down the coast. And they spent most of the summer looking from probably Canso to Yarmouth. And they settled here. Now, I don't know why. Oh, yes, I do. This is a fantastic place. And they came every year of their lives after that. And my mother was born in 1903. She came every year of her life. I was born in 1938, and I've come every year of my life in the summer.
And now your children come.
They come now. You ask me why did I come, because the 1st of July or the end of June, that's where we went. In those days, I didn't get to ask much. I was an only child, and that's the time we went to Nova Scotia. We didn't go anywhere else, and that's why I came here, learned how to sail here. My father, we have a joke in the family that anybody comes up who is not in the family, like a fiancé or a bride-to-be, they have to have the Chester test. They have to come up here and see, and if they don't like Chester, they're probably not going to make it.
In 1901, at the age of 28, Sarah married James Starr, a mining official and well known for his collection of Chinese stamps. In 1922, after the death of her mother, she inherited the family's Belfield estate. Belfield was a beautiful house, and Sarah, who valued the presence of historical landmarks for their place in American history, as well as in her personal history, wrote a brief pamphlet titled The History of Belfield. Mrs. Starr, shown here with her sister, Mrs. Meigs and Mrs. Wirtz, personally campaigned among the summer visitors.
And committees were formed, and the town, rightfully or wrongfully, refused to take responsibility because they didn't want to be saddled with the taxes and whatever else there might be, and that was okay. So that's where my grandmother jumped in. And she must have started the ball rolling by making a donation. And then she went out and one afternoon convinced about six others. She was a tough lady. And they did. The six or seven donated enough money in one afternoon to take over the endowment and whatever that is.
She died in August 1956, and her funeral was held on the grounds of Belfield, which is now part of LaSalle University. J. Kemp Bartlett, who was born in 1863, became a prominent lawyer in Baltimore, Maryland. He was a law partner of William Jennings Bryan, the three-time U.S. Democratic presidential candidate. In 1912, the Democratic National Convention was held in Baltimore. Bryan and the Kingmakers of the Democratic Party, met at J. Kemp Bartlett's Baltimore house and decided that the only person who really stood a chance of winning for the Democrats was Woodrow Wilson. Bartlett's house was at the center of the deal-making that gave Wilson the nomination and then the presidency. Wilson gave his acceptance speech from the governor's summer home in New Jersey and then came to Baltimore and repeated it to a much bigger crowd from the second floor balcony of Bartlett's house. In Chester, Bartlett bought the former home of Dr. Russell at the end of Walker Road, overlooking Big Gooseberry Island.
Well, I believe the first summer they came was in 1914. And my grandfather was a great friend of Dr. John M.T. Finney, who is the one responsible for bringing him here, because he said the salmon fishing is absolutely excellent and the sailing is perfect and I think you would absolutely love it here. And that's how they got here. They originally stayed at
Cada Lodge.
At the Cada Lodge, which then became the Lovett House. And I'm not sure how many summers they spent there, but then they moved over to the Hackmatack and were there for a number of summers until they bought the house from Dr. William Russell.
Additions were built to accommodate family visits that began in the early 1900s and continued to this day. J. Kemp Bartlett was Commodore of the Chester Yacht Club from 1920 to 1924, and his boathouse on the back harbor was used for meetings and social gatherings until the current clubhouse was purchased. The Bartletts contributed generously to the original Library Endowment Fund in 1928, and Mrs. Bartlett served on the House Committee of the Library. J. Kemp Bartlett died in 1948. Dr. John Miller Turpin Finney was born on June 20, 1863, at Natchez, Mississippi, to a country clergyman. After studying at Princeton and Harvard, he joined Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore as a physician and a surgeon. Seen assisting here in the operating theater, he eventually became chief surgeon and professor of clinical surgery. Baltimore in the early 1900s was a smoky industrial city, and it is easy to understand why people who had the means would escape the hot summers. Dr. Finney lived in an attractive neighborhood called Utah Place in a three-story brick house. Dr. Finney and his family fell in love with Chester and bought the Little Fish Island, which they use as a base for summer activities such as sailing and fishing. The island has remained in the Finney family for generations. Even though he was on vacation from Johns Hopkins, Dr. Finney and his wife, who was a nurse, would help locals from Chester and Tancook with medical problems. In addition to his work on the library's founding committee, Dr. Finney was invited to speak at the annual library garden parties, known as teas, in the early 1930s. His family was also very involved. His wife donated bookshelves for the library, and his daughter, Mary, circulated the petition to accept the gift of the property for the library. She also chaired the book committee until her marriage in 1934. Dr. Finney died in 1942. In addition to the summer visitors who served on the library's founding committee, there were a number of local people who volunteered to serve. There was a woman from East Chester named Ella Zink and Austin Evans, who was involved in his father's business in what is now the Rope Loft. A young Mabel Mitchell served as well, shown here at a Women's Institute party at the library in 1967. Mr. Carol Manning, one of the original committee members, and his wife, took over the management of the Akmatak Hotel in 1917. Another library committee member, Caroline Redden, played a large part in the way Chester looks today. She also purchased and renovated a number of houses within the village, such as the wood box shown here. There were several other families from among the summer visitors who, while not serving on the founding committee, became involved with supporting the establishment of a free community library in memory of Zoe Valley. John Greer Hibben was a Presbyterian minister, a philosopher, and an educator. He was born on April 19, in 1861, in Peoria, Illinois. He served as the 14th president of Princeton University from 1912 to 1932, succeeding Woodrow Wilson, and lived here in the president's residence with his wife and daughter. Dr. Hibben summered in Chester on the peninsula in a house called Beau Rivage. He was an early financial supporter of the library and served on the first book committee. At the library opening in August of 1928, he was one of the key speakers. Just after his retirement in 1932, he and his wife died in an automobile accident. That summer, Dr. Finney gave a speech at the annual library tea on the life and work of Dr. Hibben, his lifelong friend. Mrs. James Starr suggested that a memorial to the Hibbens in the form of books be established. Today, it still remains as an interesting time capsule of books from that period. Clarissa Anderson Gibbs, seen here as a young girl with her mother, Elizabeth, and her brother Andrew, was the daughter of Dr. Andrew Anderson Jr. of St. Augustine, Florida. Dr. Anderson was a close friend of Standard Oil magnate Henry Flagler and helped Flagler with his venture in Florida hotels and railroads. In St. Augustine, the Andersons lived at Markland, a house begun by his late father. Apparently, the heat and humidity of St. Augustine in the summer were too much for his wife, Elizabeth. Around the turn of the last century, the Anderson came to Chester on vacation. While staying at the Akmatak, they fell in love with the place. Within a week, Dr. Anderson picked out a property just over the way from the Akmatak and built a summer home. Clarissa Anderson was a major contributor to the original Library Endowment Fund in 1927. She served on the original Garden Committee for 8 years, helping to pay for the fence. She died in January 1990, and the Anderson summer home over the way was left to her grandson, John Dimmick. Henry B. McCormick graduated from Yale University in 1892 and was admitted to the Pennsylvania Bar in 1895. However, he never practiced his profession. He was a trustee of the Henry McCormick Estate. He was a sportsman and socialite who immersed himself in the lifestyle of a country gentleman. In the 1920s, Henry built a house on the peninsula in Chester and was one of the largest donors of the original Library Endowment Fund and served on the original book committee. His sister Anne was also a strong supporter of the library. In 1931, she donated the funds in memory of her sister-in-law, Mary Board McCormick, to have an extension built at the back of the library to give the custodians more living space. Henry died in 1941, leaving the Chester house to Anne. She never married, but traveled the world and took a leadership role in many volunteer organizations, most notably the Girl Scout of America. She died in 1964. Edwin W. Groves Sr. made his fortune in the pharmaceutical business. He is also well known for his hotel in Asheville, North Carolina, known as the Grove Park Inn, which opened in 1913. In the decades since, it has become one of the South's most famous and venerable resorts. Edwin Grove Jr., shown here on the right with his father and his son, lived in St. Louis, Missouri, with his wife Margaret Cephalou Grove, in a large mission-style house that is part of the Hampton Park Historic District. Summers were hot in St. Louis, and the Groves usually summered away from the city.
It started with my grandparents, Mr. and Mrs. Edwin W. Grove. They had a ranch in Colorado, probably about 1915, thereabouts. And they would go there in the summertime. When my dad was about 10 years old, that would be about 1923, he came down with a mastoid infection. And this is that spongy bone behind your ear. And before antibiotics, it was very serious. It took 2 days to get him to the nearest hospital on muleback, and it must have been a pretty close call because the family's vacation plans changed forever after that. My grandmother got the idea that it was high altitude that had caused this illness, and she swore never again to hazard the lives of her children on a high-altitude vacation. So the very next year, she started out looking for someplace else to go. She had family in Baltimore, and my guess is that stopping there, the Finneys, who have the island just across from our house on the peninsula, probably told her to take a look at Chester. And they came up, rented a house for a few years, got to like it, bought some property, and here we are today.
Edwin Jr. and Margaret started summering in Chester around 1926 on Big Gooseberry Island, where they had planned to build a large house. The Groves were major contributors to the original Library Endowment Fund in 1928, and Margaret was one of the members of the Library Garden Committee that maintained and improved the library grounds.
As I understand it, my grandmother was involved in the gardening committee for the library. Now, she loved gardens. And one of the wonderful things about Chester is the way gardens grow here. Many years ago, when we had a full-time caretaker, he was also a gardener, and our property just blossomed. I remember vegetable gardens, cutting gardens, and then the regular gardens, and this was wonderful. My grandmother in St. Louis had gardens as well, and she loved to share these with people. And I would bet that she wanted to go up and help the library look just as nice as it possibly could because it's such a beautiful spot.
The Groves purchased the Zell property for its water rights on the peninsula. Margaret fell in love with the house, and they decided to live in it around 1934. That same year, Edwin Jr. died, and Big Gooseberry Island was eventually sold. Today, the house known as Calm Waters still remains much the same as when Margaret lived there, preserved by generations of groves who still come every summer. In 2006, James and Dudley Grove renewed the Grove connection to the library by facilitating the research for the display of historical information on the Valley family, who were also from St. Louis, Missouri. The Chester branch of the Women's Institute of Nova Scotia was formed in 1923. Members raised money to improve school facilities and worked with the school board and school staff.
Their promotion and push for education and increased education, especially in rural communities, was important. Now, as kids, we sort of joked about these old ladies that met around here in the library, but they were part of a larger organization that did an enormous amount of good work in this country.
The school was only one of the many community projects undertaken by the club. When Zoe's property was first offered to the community, the Chester branch received permission from Municipal Council to sponsor the property until an endowment fund was raised. The monthly meetings of the Chester branch were held in the club room of the library for 50 years. They assisted with decorating the interior of the library, with the planting of flowers, and also donated a small sum of money each year.
Women had to work hard to provide that. And they did that principally by having a tea in the summer. And they charged 50 cents for that too, because many of the times I went through Chester and sold the tickets. And people would complain about 50 cents for a tea, sandwiches and cookies. Well, it was to support the library. Well, they didn't care who it was supporting. It was too much money for tea. They wanted a full meal for that. But anyway, Sandra and I used to go around and sell the tickets, and then we had to come up when we were old enough and help. And that meant we had to serve tea in china teacups and pass little sandwiches and sweets, and it was like high tea, English high tea. And the summer people would all come and, you know, dressed in their best dresses.
The Chester branch disbanded in 1978 at the home of Mrs. Margaret Marshall, who served many years as the Women's Institute representative on the library's committee of trustees. She continued to serve on this committee until 1995. One of the first projects of the Chester Municipal Heritage Society was the restoration of the Lightfoot Tower, which had been damaged in 1918. They worked from a small watercolor found in a library and at their opening ceremony in August of 1985. The Library Endowment Fund has never had the money to maintain the tower. In 2006, the Chester Trust took over the responsibility for the tower from the Heritage Society and began raising funds for its repair. By 1996, the library was facing serious challenges. The interior of the building was in great need of restoration, and the endowment fund had been severely depleted due to years of low interest rates. It was decided by the new librarian and his wife to try and restore the library building and grounds to reflect the spirit of Chester's early libraries. which were essentially community libraries in someone's own. As the library was intended to be a memorial to Zoe, after 70 years, it was just as much an informal museum as a library. The librarian and his wife offered to finance the restoration of the interior of the house, as the very small endowment fund had to be used for operating expenses. An annual newsletter and fundraising campaign was started to try and keep investment capital from being diminished. So far, the library has survived for 82 years through donations large and small.
Those of us lucky enough to enjoy the gift of the Zoe Valley Library have a responsibility to ensure its safety and its permanence. Therefore, contributions, however small, will guarantee this permanence.
Today, visitors come and experience one of the oldest libraries of its type in Canada. They can learn about the Valley family and the founders of the library. The book room is Zoe's original library. It features a memorial plaque that states, "This house belongs to Marie-Zoé Vallée Lightfoot. Here she still welcomes you." The original dining room is used as the reading room and houses the collection of children's books. In 2002, it was named after Sir Christopher Ondaatje in recognition of his support for the Library Endowment Fund. The club room was home to the Women's Institute Chester Branch for 50 years and is now a quiet place to read. It houses biographies, classic literature collections, and antique books, including personal volumes belonging to Zoe and her family. The room was expanded during Zoe's time by enclosing a rear veranda. All the rooms of the house have been refurbished. The current dining room was once the original kitchen of the house, built around or before 1850 by John Allen, and once featured a cooking fireplace. What is now used as the kitchen was originally the summer kitchen, where the heat of the wood stove was contained away from the rest of the house. In the early years of the library, there was a garden committee that did extensive work in making the grounds an attractive place. While no formal committee exists today, many members of the community have helped the librarian and his wife to restore the grounds by donating trees, shrubs, perennials, bulbs, and annuals. The community now has a beautiful, quiet place to read, sketch, or have photos taken. The grounds are a popular place for wedding pictures, being next to two churches, and having a variety of backgrounds for newlyweds and their families.
Dad always remembered Zoe Pondley. She was, again, she was a person who had concern for everyone and for the people in Chester. Otherwise, I mean, her house wouldn't have been used as a library. And after all these years still being used as a library, if she didn't have concern for people.
The library is a registered municipal heritage property and is part of the Nova Scotia Historic Places Initiative and listed in the Canadian Register of Historic Places. It has grown since 1928 from a simple resource into a heritage treasure, cherished by all who become familiar with his history and its representation of Chester's charm and spirit.
I've gotten involved with the library because when I was a boy up here, they weren't a lot of things for children to do. The Lido hadn't been built. The yacht club didn't have its sailing program. There wasn't a lot for children to do. The water's kind of chilly to swim in. So I would go up to the library and borrow books. And especially on those foggy, rainy days that we sometimes get in Chester, even during the summer, it was a wonderful place to visit.
Well, I think the history of the library alone must be preserved, and it's absolutely fascinating. And I think for the village people to be able to walk or to the library without having to go to one of the cities is absolutely wonderful.
I find over the years, as I've gotten more time, I'm definitely more interested in structures. I've always done all the renovations on our houses. I'm very interested in architecture. And so I look at a place like this, and whether it's Lordley Park or any of the thing, the tower, and realize that, you know, this is what keeps us here, and this is what makes Chester so visually rich, first of all, you know. So on the surface, just walking around, it's every house is slightly different from the next. And then if you do choose to stay, you start to meet the people that are in those houses, or you go over to the historical thing, and you start to learn about the people that once lived there. And I think also as you age, you become more and more interested in where you were from, and so therefore where the people in Chester were from. And so places like this, for this place to fall into disrepair and eventually be bulldozed and, something else that's going to last 30 years, because everything that's built now is not built to last, right, would be a terrible loss to the village.
And if we don't look after the built heritage, the more ethereal heritage disappears too.
Without heritage, we are nothing. And history repeats itself. The greatest gift anybody can give to a nation is a library. Without learning, we are nothing. And libraries ensure our ability to learn. We must preserve our heritage.
Above all else, the story of the Zoe Valley Library is the story of falling in love with Chester, of choosing to live under its enchantment and to share it with all those who somehow find it on their path.
The islands, beautiful, the intermixing of water and land. And I suppose those are the real reasons why our family continues to love it here. It's just a beautiful place to be. And Chester still has a pretty loose natural quality. As you walk through the village, you see the old apple trees that have sort of been untended for many years, decades, and they just keep on producing their apples, and the wildflowers on the sides of the roads and the grassy ditches and whatnot. And yeah, they're the great qualities of Chester.
Because we absolutely love Chester, we love the beauty, the fishing, the sailing, the people here. It's just wonderful. And all I can say for me is that this is truly where my heart is right here.
And for me, it's also the maintaining the connection with the past through the house. And the house is filled with memorabilia in the attic, so books from when my father was a child are here, and when I was a child, so that my son can read those books too, and old toys, old letters, everything connects me with the past on both sides of my family.
I'm starting to join more groups, go to more meetings, and starting to, I suppose, care more about the village. I feel it needs to change because people need to be able to make a living. I have a lot of friends who do make a living here and they struggle, but also realizing how, okay, with that change, we don't want devastation, right? So yeah, as far as will we continue, why do we continue to stay? Because sort of with preschoolers, with kids in school, with teenagers, and now as empty nesters, it continues to be interesting. And it continues to be interesting because of learning about history and meeting the other people that have moved here.
The population of the world now is three times that which it was when Kennedy was assassinated in 1963. And Chester is one of the few places in the world that is still unspoilt. We are lucky to be here. We are Canadian, and we have been coming here now for over 30 years. It's the only place in the world that our entire family comes to congregate. And we congregate every year on Meisner's Island. It's a fantastic get-together. These are our roots, and our roots will stay here. Thank God for Chester.
We end our journey with Zoe's own words. I cannot pretend in these slight sketches to bring them back from that gray place where all forgotten things go, nor to raise them from the dust into which they have fallen. I have tried only to give the pale spirit of a picture whose colors must need be faded in these long, long time. I have tried only to rouse their ghost that they may walk a while, and then lie down again to sleep in those beautiful gray old houses in that quaint old village where they sang, danced, laughed, and wept 100 years ago.